then, on the one hand, if I minimize, well, okay, so what's obvious? So I look at the set of measures gamma, having these two guys as its marginals, and I look at the set of functions u integral with respect to m plus and v integral with respect to m minus limits such that u plus v dominates s. And basically, we saw if you integrate this inequality against gamma, then you will have that this is less than or equal to integral u against gamma, but since u doesn't depend on gamma, gamma has u plus as its marginal, I get the expectation of u against u plus, and since v doesn't depend on x, and gamma has u minus as its right marginal, I get the expectation of v against v minus. And so since this is true for all uv in here and all gamma in here, I might as well take a maximum on this side. And so the first claim that I want to establish is that equality holds and the infimum is attained. Yes.
So why is the notation for that set Li be some S?
Yeah, it's odd notation, but essentially, if S is Lipschitz, then we can restrict our attention to functions u and v in here, which enjoy the same Lipschitz bound as S. Other questions? So actually, when Kanrovich originally did this, he was interested in S being the distance function on a metric space. And in that case, we can restrict our attention to functions u and v that are with one Lipschitz, Lipschitz with constant one. And in fact, u equal minus v. Then because S satisfies the triangle inequality, it turns out you can take u v minus v. And okay, well, I flipped sign conventions a couple of times, so this doesn't look like a Lipschitz bound at all. It looks like it should go the other way. But it's just a sign convention. Here I've adopted the sign conventions that are consistent with this economic matching problem where you imagine that if X marries Y, they get surplus S, and then they're trying to share it with each other in such a way that you you attain a set of stable pairings of husbands and wives. Okay. And so it's pretty straightforward, it's pretty standard to show that the maximum is attained here, so that somehow that's step one. So what's the point? The point is that the probability measure, so if I equip this with the supremum norm, then this becomes the Banach space. And the probability measures, so gamma lives in the set of probability measures on the product space. And that, in turn, is a subset of unit ball, unit because these measures have mass 1, in the set of signed measures. And this thing normed by total variation is essentially the Banach space dual of continuous functions. I'll call that.
At least,
you know, at least if these spaces M plus and M minus are compact, and if they're only locally compact, so then you have to be slightly careful that you deal with functions that go to zero and infinity and so on.
So what is gamma again?
Gamma is the set of non-negative measures on the product space, having the property that if I project all the mass of gamma onto the first factor, I see the given mass mu plus, and if I project all the mass of gamma onto the second factor, I see mu minus. Right? So pi plus push forward gamma equals mu plus, and pi minus push forward gamma equals mu minus, where pi plus of x, y is x, and pi minus is y is y. So the Banach ala Oblu theorem tells us that the unit ball is weak star compact. So in other words, you can, given any sequence of measures in the unit ball, you can find a subsequence which converges in the sense that for every continuous bounded test function, the integral of the test function against the subsequence converges to the integral against the limit. If M plus and M minus are compact, then the set of probability measures are compact. If they're non-compact, then mass could leak out at infinity. Anyhow, this thing, because the marginals are constrained to be mu plus and mu minus, and they each have mass 1, you can't have any measure leaking out at infinity. So even on non-compact spaces, this will be a compact subset. So I guess what I really want to say is this is weak star compact. This is a continuous function. S is a continuous bounded function, so I'm maximizing on a continuous function on a compact subset. So the max is attained. Great. So basically, I'm going to show there are various ways to show this duality. And of course, if you look in Delaunay's book, you'll see a sort of abstract proof based on Fankel-Rockefeller duality. What I'm actually going to do today is a little bit different. I'm going to take the optimizer gamma over here, and I'm going to use it to construct U. While we do the construction of U from gamma, we're going to see various properties of U that are going to be relevant to us as we go forward. So that's one of the reasons to do it this way. So I guess I need a definition. So a subset in a product space is cyclically monotone, is S cyclically monotone. If for every integer and sequence of points, a set, the sum of S and permutation sigma on k letters the sum over this finite sequence of points is maximized by the assignment of y to x's as opposed to any permutation of the y's with respect to the x's. And so if we think back to the stable marriage problem, this is basically saying that we've chosen the permutation of y's with respect to the x's that maximizes the sum of the surpluses. And so our first lemma is a sort of variational lemma, which says that if gamma optimizes the left-hand side.
Sorry, are you only permuting the I on the y?
That's right.
Okay.
I only want to permute, I want to keep the order of the husbands fixed and permute the order of the wives or vice versa. If gamma optimizes S, then the support of gamma is S cyclically monotone. Where by support I mean the smallest, the intersection of all closed sets. With the property that they carry the full mass of gamma. And so basically this is not too hard to prove. So let gamma be optimal. Trouble, the chalk is splintering on me. So gamma, let gamma be a maximizer on the left-hand side. And to derive a contradiction, suppose its support is not cyclically monotone. So what does that mean? It means that I can find, for some integer k, a permutation on k letters. I can find a sequence of points in the support of gamma, such that the inequality goes the wrong way. If k was 3, I might have a sequence of points like this. And the sum of the surplus at these three points, let me call them z1, z2, z3, is maybe less than the sum of the surplus at these three points here, 01, 02, and 03, which are obtained from the z's by permuting the. So in other words, the projection of the o's onto the y-axis are the same as the projection of the z's, and the projection of o's onto the x-axis are the same as the projection of the z's onto the x-axis. And so basically, what's the idea? So the idea is that, remember, the zi's belong to the support of gamma. And so what I would like to do is I'd like to subtract a little bit of mass from gamma at the zi's, and I would like to replace it at the oi's. And I need to be a little careful doing this because I need to not change. I want to construct a perturbation of gamma, but it should still be in this set for which the surplus is larger. And okay, gamma vanishes at points, so I should enlarge the points to little neighborhoods. And now gamma assigns positive mass to these three neighborhoods. And because this inequality is strict and S is continuous, if I make the neighborhood small enough, this inequality is going to hold in the entire neighborhoods. And so now, whatever the I have the restriction of gamma to each of these three sets. Those are all positive measures. I can subtract a little bit of each of those three positive measures from gamma, and I have to add it back in these three sets here. And I have to be careful to do it in such a way that whatever I that the marginal projections don't change. And then. The result will be that the perturbed gamma, the difference in surplus between the perturbed, the new gamma and the old gamma, will be basically I'll have added these 3 points and subtracted those 3 points, and I'll have one on the surplus because of the strict inequality. And so then there's a kind of beautiful theorem which says, so this is due in the case, where, maybe I should give a definition first. Yeah. So whenever I have a function u on m plus, I'm going to define the so-called S subdifferential of U. And it's going to be a set of points xy in m plus cross m minus such that this inequality holds. And I guess it wouldn't hurt to allow you to take plus infinity at some points as long as it's not identically plus infinity. And in the special case where S is the inner product, so this is M plus M minus subsets of spaces. Space of the same dimension, then the right-hand side here would become dot minus xy plus u of x, and you can understand this to be the, this is the first order Taylor expansion. U at x, provided that y is the derivative of u. So obviously, if I set dot equal to x, I'm going to have equality here. And if u was a differentiable function, and I wanted to have this inequality for all dot, in this case, I would need to take y to be the derivative. Otherwise, somewhere in a neighborhood of X, that, you know, arbitrarily close to X, I'm going to violate this inequality. So now there's this theorem that goes back to Rockefeller in the case of the inner product. And I know it from Roche in the general case. I don't know whether he was the first guy to do it or not, general case. But it says that whenever you have maybe before I state the theorem, I should say a remark. So, so the homework is to check that for any function u, the subdifferential, this S subdifferential of u, is S cyclically monotone. Right, it has this property over here. And the theorem is basically a converse to the homework. So the homework's the easy direction and the converse is the slightly more subtle direction. And it says that if S has the cyclical monotonicity property, then there exists a U with the property that, such that S is contained in the subdifferential. So somehow I can, So somehow I can build a function u out of an S cyclically monotone set. And that's exactly what we want to do in order to establish Cantor-Rovich's theorem, is we want to start with the support of the optimal gamma. And we want to find the u and v which produce equality in the statement of duality. And so this construction is going to produce the u for us. And so let's see, I'm going to fix. Let me start by assuming I have a cyclically monotone set and fix some point in it. And now I'm going to set u to be some maximum. Considering a maximum over all integers k and over all chains. And set s of so I'm going to pair the x over here with the last y in this chain, and I'm going to pair each x in the chain with the partner of the previous guy. So the first x gets paired with y0, and then I'm going to subtract from that. All of these guys. And maybe it's, I don't know, maybe it's nicer to write this as a sum from 1 to k and then add and subtract x0, y0 at the end. And my claim is that this guy does the job. And so i.e., I need to show for every x, y, and s, I need u to be larger than so I need that. And so how am I going to do this? Given x, y, and s, and epsilon greater than 0, I can, because of this definition here, I can always find a k and a chain such that the right-hand side comes within epsilon of u. To get this system here, I simply take k plus 1 and xk plus 1, yk plus 1 to be xy, and I plug them back into this definition that gives me a lower bound for u dot. So u dot will certainly be larger than s of dot yk plus 1. Yk plus 1 is y, and then I have this sum up to k plus 1 of s of xi yi minus 1. And I probably would like to separate off, I'd like to keep the first k terms of this sum, and I'd like to separate off the last one, which is s of k plus 1 yk minus s of xk yk. And xk plus 1 yk plus 1. Great. And hopefully this stuff here. Oops. Yes, that stuff there is bigger than ux minus epsilon. So xk, yk, the last term over there is xy, and these other terms here are bigger than ux minus epsilon. And that's the inequality I wanted up to epsilon, but epsilon was arbitrary. So it looks like I'm done. What do you notice that's peculiar about this proof?
So there's something extremely peculiar about this proof, and that is that I haven't used the hypothesis.
So what will go wrong with this proof if S is not S equivalently monotone? Capital S is not little S equivalently monotone.
This suit blow up.
Yeah, so I have to worry that U is identically plus infinity. And then I can't, if that's the case, then I can't achieve, like, given epsilon, I can't achieve this. And what S cyclical monotonicity does for me is it prevents U from becoming identically plus infinity. So in particular, U of x0 will be a soup of things of the form. If this is x0, yk, then because it's a soup of things, but the things over here are all less than 0. And so the supremum is still less than 0. And so basically, the S cyclical monotonicity prevents you from blowing up at the point that I started out with. And once I have that, then this proof here shows that, in particular, whenever x, y is an S, if I put x0 here, it shows me that U of x can't be too big relative to x0. It can't be more than 0 plus twice the supernorm of S. And by it's easy to show that U of x infinity can't be too much less than 0 if you just take a short chain, take a chain of length 1 or something, and then U of x0 can't be less than 2 times the supernorm of S either. And so this proof also shows that U stays bounded, at least for those x's where I have a pair of set S. Okay, so let's finally, I want to introduce C transforms, or S transforms in this case. All right, so before I do that, maybe I should make some further remarks about this proof. So, the remark is that if you have a map, a vector field, so we call it integrable. If
z. Or exact, or whatever, if z is u for some c1 function on M. In other words, or potential. And when M plus is simply connected, the integral around any closed curve of z sigma s dot sigma dot s ds vanishing is necessary and sufficient for S2 potential. And in some sense, this is a kind of discrete analog of that, particularly in the case S equals x dot y. Then we're kind of replacing this integral by a sum of the form, I guess. Well, I could, here I had the y's changing, but I could equally well have the x's changing. I could have yi and xi minus xi minus 1. So what am I trying to say? I'm trying to say that capital S, which is contained in the product space, is playing the role of my Z. And this family of discrete inequalities for all K and for all selections of points X and Y in here is playing the role of this integral. And and this is the conclusion of this of Rockefeller's theorem. The fact that there is some u whose subdifferential contains s is playing the role of finding this this function, the potential function u for us. And of course, in this case here, you would fix some base point x naught, and you would integrate from the vector field along any curve joining x naught to x in order to figure out the value of u at x, and that's what this supremum is doing for us in this proof. I want to say that given possibly a job of infinity, so I'm given a function on m plus u and a pairing s between m plus and m minus, and so I get a function on m minus by taking the supremum. And similarly, if I started out with a function v on m minus, I could define I could define a function on m plus by taking a supremum with respect to y. So now I'm ready to conclude the proof of Cantor-Rovich duality. Maybe I should make some remarks about this.
So what is X convexity?
Okay. So remark one. If UV is in the S, right, so remember that this was basically the set of functions such that S of XY is less than UX plus VY. Let's say BS and B is also in the BS, and BS is actually less than U. So that's remark one. And it's not terribly hard to see. So if I have this inequality here, by bringing V over to the left-hand side, and then taking a supremum on Y, that's my BS. And so that's this inequality here. And on the other hand, from this definition here, I see that S of X plus V of Y is bigger than S of Y, so that's this inequality here. So that's what we're looking here. So that's remark one. And then remark two is that if I do this operation and then do this operation and then do this operation again, which I will abbreviate by writing this kind of thing, that's the same as doing this once. And that's basically, the proof of remark two is basically an iteration of remark one.
So the definition, the first definition there, is it an S tilde or something?
I wanted to distinguish the supremum over M plus from the supremum over M minus.
Okay.
And so I made this one an S and that one an S tilde.
Okay.
But they're symmetrical. The operations are symmetrical. And so let's see the proof of remark two. So if I iterate remark one, then I see that UV in like S implies BSE. I'm just rewriting remark one once more. And so now I have this thing in lib S, so I do remark one again, except with the S tilde operation instead of the S operation, and I get the S tilde also in lib S, and the S tilde less than B. So if I do this operation twice, I never end up larger than where I started. I'm pointwise smaller than my original function. And now let me do the operation a third time. So this is in lib S. So I can apply the S transform to this again. And I get I get half of the conclusion. And on the other hand, if I start from here, and I apply the S tilde transform to this, because the S tilde transform involves a minus sign, if VS is less than U, maybe I want to start from here and apply the S transform to this. So if V double is less than V, and I apply the S transfer to both of them because of this minus sign here, I'm going to get the triple is bigger than the S. And that's the opposite conclusion. So that's the Hoover remark two. And so we say, so somebody said, what is S convex? So we say U is S convex if it's invariant under applying this operation twice. And similarly, V would be S tilde convex if VS S tilde equals V. And so what's an example of an S convex function? This guy is an example. This guy is an example here that we just checked that in remark two. And again, all of the definition and the structure and everything are motivated by the case of the inner product XY. So in that case, so for each x, this is an affine linear function of y. I take a supremum such things, I get a convex function. And this is better known as the so-called Finkel-Rockefeller conjugate of U. And if I twice transform U under this operation, I get the something smaller than what I started out with, I get the largest convex function underneath my original function U. So the lower of U is convex half. And if I do it three times, I get back whatever I did if I did it once. Right, so by now it's gotten erased. But so this is one way to produce convex functions, is you take a U and you do this. Another one is if you look at the proof of Rockefeller's theorem, the Rockefeller-Roget theorem, you will see that in this case here, the supremum was again an affine, it was the supremum of things that were affine linear in dot. And so the proof of the Rockefeller-Finkel theorem in this case produces a convex function for you. Which, so that's already a pretty strong hint at where Renier's convex function is coming from in the Renier theorem that we talked about yesterday. Okay, so let's conclude the proof of Kantorovich duality. So let gamma optimize S. So gamma has S cyclically monotone support by our lemma, and so by the Rockefeller-Roget theorem, so our lemma, so support gamma is S cyclically monotone. And then Rockefeller-Roget tells us that there exists U with support gamma in the S subdifferential of U. And so my claim is that the call we checked at the beginning of the hour, integral of S to gamma was less than the int
UV nu plus speed UV minus, where U and V were in of F. So all I need to do is exhibit a U and a V that produce equality here. And my my claim is that, so I should call this U bar and V bar to distinguish them from this U that Rockefeller Roche just produced for us. And my claim is that U and its S conjugate that attains the infimum and produces equality.
So this support gamma is in this differential thing of the U. It's not not equal.
Right. So at least for the inner product, Rockefeller's theorem said something like a cyclically monotone subset of Rn cross Rn is, which is also maximal, so which is not contained in any other cyclically monotone subset of Rn cross Rn, is exactly equal.
Okay,
yeah.
Got it.
Right. Right, so what I need to do is I need to go back to the definition of subdifferential and massage it a little bit. So it's the set of xy such that what did we say? We said u dot should be bigger than s dot y minus sxy plus u of x. So equivalently, s of dot y minus u dot is less than for all dot. Is less than s of x y minus u of x. So so I can take supremum. And on the other hand, if by taking dot equals x, I see that equality is obtained. So what I've shown is that whenever I'm in the subdifferential, that implies that equality holds. And so therefore, this condition here tells me that gamma vanishes outside the zero set of kxy, which is ux plus us tilde. Right, from the definition of us tilde, this is always non-negative. And this condition here, and the fact that k vanishes on the subdifferential u, tells me that k is zero on the support of gamma. And so I integrate this thing, so with respect to gamma, and I get integral of u d mu plus plus integral of u s tilde d mu minus equals integral of s gamma. And so that, and right, so the other thing to notice is that when C is bounded, the U and the US tilde are both in L infinity. So I don't have any trouble computing these two integrals when C is a bounded continuous function. Separating these, and that shows that I've produced equality here. So the U and the US tilde, US tilde from Rockefeller's theorem are actually attaining the inf. Remarks one and two. This was the US tilde. Show that US double tilde are again in the S, and since this was like a lower S convex hull of U, this thing is less than U. And from the point of view of this minimization here, being less than U is an advantage. And so also attain the inf. And this guy has the advantage that it's equal to so if I define B to be this thing, I can always find a pair attaining the int such that U is the S transform of V and V is the S tilde transform of U. So not only is the int attained, by some S conjugate pair. Of S convex functions. And so I guess maybe that's a good place to stop and take it from there tomorrow, and I will come back to this question. What can we say about maps between unequal dimensional spaces?
So we haven't seen, so at this point, we are yet to see why the capital problem is related to the Hermitian problem.
Right. And in fact, for the relationship hold, somebody reminded me during the break yesterday. Although in principle, because of the Cantor-Rochefort's relaxation of Monge's problem, it might give you a lower number.
Right.
And there are actually examples that do this when both measures have point masses in them, or at least the first measure has point masses in it. I think Aldo Pertelli has a result that says as long as the first measure is free from atoms, then the Monge infimum coincides with the Cantor-Rochefort infimum. And so that's another thing I will do tomorrow is I'll start to assume a little bit more differentiability of my surplus S. I'll start to assume that it's C1, and then give conditions on it such that the Cantor-Rochefort infimum is attained by a Monge function. Right. See you tomorrow afternoon.